You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi class, this is Ryan Butler, your TA, back again for our continuing lecture series within PSY101. Today we're going to be talking about intelligence and what defines intelligence, the current debate surrounding intelligence, and why we as clinicians would want to use intelligence as a certain measure for helping our clients or our patients. The definition of intelligence is something that is a bit difficult to really grasp. There's a lot of different definitions going around surrounding what intelligence actually is. One of the first definitions we're going to talk about is from Zimbardo, who was the person behind the Stanford Prison Experiment, a really famous experiment if you don't know about it. And his definition of intelligence is the global capacity to profit from experience and go beyond information about the environment. Sternberg, another psychologist with his own theory of intelligence, defined it as the mental activity directed toward purposive adaptation to selection and shaping of real-world environments relevant to one's life. Still, another definition comes from the Webster's Dictionary, which is the ability to understand or to deal with new or trying situations, reason, and then all caps, so the ability to reason. And these definitions differ in some way, right? There is one definition says this, one definition says that. In general, we could probably consider intelligence to be considered something that is the ability to retain and utilize information. But let's go into a couple of theories about, or actually the most popular theories about what intelligence actually is. So the first and probably the earliest theory that we're going to talk about is from Charles Spearman, who talked about general intelligence. So Charles Spearman was a psychologist who was trying to define and measure intelligence. And what he found through a series of factor analyses, which is a statistical method, was that a lot of people who were doing cognitive tests would score highly on one section of cognitive test and would score highly on a different section of the cognitive test. Vice versa, someone who didn't score that well on one cognitive test did not score well on another one. So to use the example with the memes there, it's big brain time. In one situation, he's able to use his intelligence to overcome the situation or to better understand the situation. And then in another situation, he's able to use almost that same intelligence. So what Charles Spearman was able to factor out is what he called the G factor. So the G factor is basically what's called the general intelligence factor. Spearman believed that intelligence was derived from one source within the mind and then would become applied in different situations depending on where the person would find themselves. So the next theory of intelligence that came about was from Raymond Cattell. And Raymond Cattell proposed that, no, intelligence is not just one thing, it's two different things. There's crystallized and then there's fluid intelligence. So crystallized and fluid intelligence basically means you have crystallized intelligence, which is almost like your database. It's, you know, how much you have in your brain, what you remember, facts and figures. And then you have fluid intelligence, which is your ability to solve new problems. So to use the puzzle example that's behind me right there, if you have a high crystallized intelligence, for example, let's backtrack it. So let's say you've done this puzzle about four or five times, and you have a really good memory about how to do a puzzle. You would say that you have a high crystallized intelligence because you would probably put this puzzle together faster than someone who doesn't have this knowledge about the puzzle. For fluid intelligence, this would be if you were to given a new puzzle that no one has ever done before, and you're able to put it together faster than someone who is in the same scenario as you. They've never seen this puzzle before. You would be said to have high fluid intelligence. So to continue on to this idea of multiple intelligences, another famous theorist that came about was, let me just check my notes, was Thurstone. So Thurstone was the next big intelligence theory that came about, and he proposed that intelligence is derived from a series of primary mental abilities. So that intelligence isn't just, you know, it's not just a general intelligence factor, it's not crystallized and fluid intelligence, it's sort of like all of the above. It is multiplicitous, there's multiple things that cover intelligence. So his primary mental abilities that he thought, you know, that you can measure in terms of different intelligences are verbal comprehension, reasoning, perceptual speed, numerical ability, word fluency, associative memory, and spatial visualization. So to Thurstone, he believed that someone could be intelligent in one of these primary mental abilities and may be lacking in another mental ability. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're not intelligent, it's just that they're intelligent in a different capacity. Like one person may be really good with numbers, another person may be a very good visual learner, another person may be really good with speaking and with language. So further, like kind of actually building off of this, was, I'm just looking for the name really quick, Howard Gardner. So Howard Gardner proposed what was called the theory of multiple intelligences. So to Howard Gardner, he believed that, or he believes, I should say, he's still alive. So he believes that intelligence can't be defined simply by an IQ score. So we're all familiar with IQ tests. People sometimes boast about how high their IQ is, and that is supposed to define how intelligent they are. Howard Gardner proposed that intelligence is more than just an IQ score. There's different things that constitute intelligence. So his big ones that came about were visual spatial, interpersonal, which basically means your ability to actually work with people, to relate to people, intrapersonal, and there's a difference there with the RA, basically saying that you have a really good ability to have insight about yourself, musical ability, and a host of other ones. But the two that he also included in there that are also included in, say, IQ scores and the general intelligence factor are the linguistic, verbal, and the logical and mathematical. Typically, a lot of intelligence tests will stay within those domains, ability to use logic and reason, your verbal ability, as well as your mathematical ability. But again, to Howard Gardner, intelligence was more than just an IQ score. There's more going on here. So the next one that came about, and this is from Sternberg. Sternberg basically said that intelligence, okay, that's great that you can have these different intelligence, multiple intelligences, but who's to say that those are not just talents? You can have a talent for, if we go back to the intelligence, the multiple intelligence, you can have an ability to be really good with exercise, right? But it doesn't necessarily mean that you're intelligent in exercise. Sternberg came back and said that there is three kinds of intelligences, the triarchic theory of intelligence, essentially. So you have analytical intelligence at the top there, which is problem solving, your ability to problem solve. Creative intelligence, which allows you to deal with new abilities or deal with new situations using past experiences. And then practical intelligence, which is the ability to read and adapt to the context of everyday life. So sort of adjusting yourself depending on the real situations you find yourself in. So let's actually look at a real example of where we may see Sternberg's triarchic theory of intelligence taking place. So let's pretend that you crash land on an island, right? You're on a desert island by yourself. You don't know how to get off. So let's look at how these three different intelligences would play into the scenario. So the first one would be your analytical intelligence. Your analytical intelligence, your ability to problem solve, is going to allow you to see that, oh, there's a whole bunch of trees, there's a whole bunch of wood going on. So you would be able to, reason that I can take this wood and build a boat to get off the island. Then you could say your creative intelligence comes into play because you're able to look at the materials you have and create a boat from the materials that you have and based on your past knowledge of what a boat looks like. There's a specific shape to a boat. You may have a really good idea of how a boat should work and you're able to create this boat based on what you have around you. And then the last one, your practical intelligence may come into play as well, where you're able to say, I see a big storm coming off on the horizon, so realistically I can't build this boat right now, I'm going to wait until the storm passes, maybe build shelter first, and then after I build shelter, I can build the boat and then get off the island. So going back to all of our theories of intelligences, there's a huge debate about what intelligence is, and you can see that there's different ways that intelligence has been defined by these different theorists. But why would we want to actually measure someone's intelligence? There's a few reasons that we want to measure someone's intelligence. And the first one is it helps us assess the client's abilities. So their strengths and weaknesses. So if we go back to that example that we were thinking about, when we measure intelligence, their verbal ability, their logic ability, their mathematical ability, we may be able to see what their strengths and weaknesses are and therefore adjust our interventions to suit their strengths rather than their weaknesses. It can also enable us to see progress. So if we are able to measure someone's intelligence from, you know, the first part before we started, we may be able to see that they may have improved intelligence after this intervention. Vice versa in neuropsychological assessments. So if we have an intelligence measure from before an accident and we have an intelligence measure after an accident, we may be able to see what specific things within the brain are affected by that traumatic brain injury. And that's that last part too, which it can assess possible damage. So another big one that actually is not on the slide, but something more of an aside as well, is there's actually an entire host of disorders that are related to this, which is intellectual disability, right? So, and then the other name, and then just let me find it really quick because there's another name. Intellectual developmental disorder, which is a, you know, it's a neurodevelopmental disorder where basically you have a really strong disability in learning. And using intelligence tests, we may be able to measure and assess to see if a child or an adult may be dealing with this disorder and therefore help them out with this and identify their problem. For example, depression, which major depressive disorder, actually has a lot of correlation with intellectual developmental disability, mainly because you have a difficulty concentrating. And if you have a difficulty concentrating, you probably have difficulty, you know, retaining information. So we could rule out depression as an issue with someone who has an issue learning. We can say because of these measures that we're using, it's pointing us in the direction of intellectual disability. All right, and that is the total lecture about intelligence. Again, it's a very controversial topic. It's something that there is debate over, and you, as you can see from this lecture, there's a lot of theories going around about what actually constitutes intelligence. But what about you? What do you think? Do you think intelligence is simply a G factor, a general intelligence factor that happens to be in every single thing that we do? Or do you believe that there are multiple intelligences? Maybe the triarchic theory of intelligence from Sternberg? Or do you believe there's even eight intelligences, as Howard Gardner said? Something to think about. Thank you for tuning in.